Here you go, Jen. I'll let you take that. Are we on?
Yes, sir.
Are we on? Praise God. God is so good. You ready to break the bread of the word?
Amen.
Who's excited about the word? I am.
Amen.
Man, I am. God, boy, I get more and more excited all the time. But without a joke, it just ain't the same. I'm kidding. I got this joke is kind of cute. Oh, I got this and kind of hit. You know, do you ever get a letter in the mail and they misspell your last name? And we probably all got stories. This one cracks me up. This one place has got me down is Chris Firehurst. And I thought, my word, that is a cool name for a band. Isn't it? Please welcome Firehurst. I thought it was funny. But here's one. It says, Bob forgot his wedding anniversary. His wife was mad. She told him, tomorrow morning, I expect to find a gift in the driveway that goes from 0 to 206 seconds, and it better be there. The next morning, when his wife woke up, she looked out the window to find a box, gift wrapped in the middle of the driveway. She opened it and found a brand new bathroom scale. Bob has been missing since Friday. Moving right along. All right. I've entitled this message, Healing the Withered Hand of the Church, or something to that effect. You know that in all, in the miracles that Jesus did, the physical miracles that Jesus did, you know there's a spiritual lesson? Did you know that? Let me show you one. Matthew 14, we'll start with verse 23. I'll just show you this, and then we'll get into where I think we're going. Matthew 14. And about verse 23, somewhere near. And Jesus, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. Isn't that powerful? Jesus, prayer means to look towards God, to look towards the Father, to set your desire towards God. Isn't that amazing that Jesus prayed? Isn't that amazing? You know, the Lord's been showing me, if you understand prayer for what it is, prayer is just an act of dependence upon God. And Jesus, when he physically walked this earth, needed his Father, right? Okay? Now watch this. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain to pray, apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. Next verse. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary. Next verse. And in the fourth watch of the night, the night was divided into four parts, 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. 9 p.m. to 12 a.m., 12 a.m. to 3 a.m., and 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. The fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Next, and you know the lesson here. This was a literal miracle, miraculous situation, right? Jesus walked on water, correct? But you know there's a lesson here, right? What is the lesson? Jesus was walking on top of the situation that was threatening to kill them. Amen. Okay, I'm gonna show you the spiritual lesson because then we're gonna go another place. Next verse. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. Next verse. But straightway or immediately Jesus spake unto them, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." You know, God's always saying, "Be not afraid." You know, I know times when people ask for prayer and you see a negative situation and those things come, immediately fear a lot of times will try to grab your heart. And God is still saying, be not afraid. Isn't that awesome? God hasn't given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Fear is basically a belief that God doesn't care about you. This is why our hearts need to be settled and grounded in the love of God. You know, God's love for you is not about the purity of your heart, it's about the purity of His. Anybody hear that? It's about Him. That's why it's good news. That's why you can count on it. That's why it doesn't fluctuate, because it's based on Him. But it takes your effort to keep your faith in Him. Because if you don't keep your faith in Him, you'll automatically go back to you. It's automatic. All right. But immediately Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." Next verse. And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it be thou or you, bid me come unto thee on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." In other words, you know the story. Peter had a word from the Lord, correct?
Amen.
Now, this is a literal miracle with spiritual lessons. This is my point. This is a literal miracle with spiritual lesson, spiritual lessons for you and I, right? Okay? This really isn't the lesson. I'm just using this to show you how you can learn from everything that Jesus did. You can learn from a physical miracle, and you can get a lesson in your life. And you can learn something, okay? So Peter, what did he have? He had a word from God. You know, and any time you're believing God for anything, you need a word from God. Some people say, I'm believing God. Well, what word are you standing on? They used to ask Brother Hagin. They said, well, what are you standing on? What word are you standing on? Well, I don't have one. He goes, that's exactly what you'll get, nothing. Because the word of God is the seed. We need a promise. God's got a promise for all of us. And not just what someone else said, what God gives you. God wants to give you a promise. If you're believing for something, what promise are you standing on? Peter had a word from the Lord. Amen? Come. If it's you, Jesus bid me come. He said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Now, we talk about Peter sinking, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. But, you know, he's the only guy recorded in Scripture other than Jesus that walked on the water. Right. Pretty amazing. So he had a word from God. Next verse. And when he, Peter, saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. In other words, when he saw the circumstances, instead of seeing Jesus, he was afraid. And that's the way it is in any situation. How do you see Jesus? You see Jesus in the Word. You have a promise. You see Jesus in the Word. That's how you see Him. You keep your focus on Him. And let's say, now the Bible says, and when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, Lord, save me. Leave that verse up there. Now, I've looked at this because I wanted to make sure that that's what it said in the Greek, beginning to sink. I've never began to sink. I just sink. But see, what is the lesson here? When he took his eyes off of Jesus, the Bible said, he began to sink. That's how it is in our life. That's why Jesus said, he taught about abiding in him in John 15. Keeping your faith in him. Keeping your focus on him. There's so many distractions out there to get your focus off of him. Amen? But it says when he started looking at the circumstances, instead of looking at the author and finisher of his faith, Jesus, the Bible says he began to sink. And that's the way it is in our life too. When we get our focus off of Jesus and his promises and what he's done and what he said and off of that relationship with the Lord, the Bible says we begin to sink. We begin to sink. This is why a lot of times people don't see that. What you sow today is what you'll reap tomorrow. It's the truth. People don't get that. Now, God loves you, and you know what miracles are for? Miracles mean that there's a crisis. And thank God for miracles. Amen? But there's a better way to walk. God wants us to walk in blessing, keeping our focus on Him, not waiting till we're in the midst of a crisis to cry out to Him. And that's what happened here. Look, he began to sing. The Bible says, he, Peter, cried out saying, Lord, save me. Next verse. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore or why did you doubt? Isn't that amazing? Even in the midst of the situation where Peter started to sink, he cries out and he says, Lord, save me, and God still intervenes. Amen? Isn't that awesome? Isn't God good? But here's the point. Jesus is walking on top of the circumstance, on top of the water, the circumstance that was killing them. Number two, he told Peter to come. You can walk on through me by keeping your focus on me. You can walk on top of this circumstance. He didn't say the circumstance. It doesn't say that the circumstance immediately left. Now, eventually it did. Look at the next verse. I think it says, and when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. You know the wind's going to cease, amen? Amen. The controversy is going to cease. Now here's my point. This literal miracle has a strong spiritual lesson for your life and mine. Amen. All right? Now, here I said all that to say, that's really not the lesson. Go to Mark chapter 3. This is the message. This is the message right here. Mark chapter, I was reading this a week or two ago, minding my own business, Mark chapter 3, verse 1, minding my own business, and all of a sudden I started seeing some things. And he, Jesus, entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. Leave this up. Jesus went somewhere. This is a literal miracle. But Jesus went into the synagogue. Jesus went into the religious system, and there was a man there with a withered hand. A withered hand speaks of our activity. If your hand is withered, you're going to have trouble doing what you need to do. And Jesus went right into the synagogue, and there was a man there with a withered hand. In other words, religion can't do it for you.
Right.
Amen? And you know, Jesus is still going into the religious system, because I believe when the church gets straightened out, and I'm not talking about doing everything perfect. As long as you have people, you're going to have people at all different levels. You're going to have, you know, the mess, the oxen mess. You're going to have all that kind of stuff. But when we get to where we're unified in Christ, the world's going to see Jesus. The Bible says, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, by your love one for another." Amen? Wow, praise God. Then there was light. So Jesus entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. Now, I apply this spiritually. There's a lot of people in the church that have a withered hand. What do you mean by that? They're hurt. The Bible doesn't say whether he was born with this withered hand or whether it was injured. But I'm here to tell you that there's a lot of people in the church that are injured.
Amen.
They're injured. They're hurt. I said this with this whole Revive Ohio thing. I said, this is what I know. There's a lot of people that are hurt. There's a lot of pastors that are hurt. There's a lot of people that have a distrust. There's a lot of those things going on. But God wants to heal that. Aren't you glad? You know what this is about, guys? This is about getting, number one, as many people born again as we can. Number two, getting all those people discipled, which was Jesus' great commission, not just leading them to the Lord and having a baby and sitting them in the corner, but getting them to where they're discipled, where they're grown in the Lord, where they're growing, glowing, and touching other people. Amen? But you cannot do that. You can't function properly if you've got a withered hand. Let me say, Jesus entered the synagogue. Let me show you this in Revelation 22, verse 16. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 16. How many know we've all been hurt? You know why a lot of people reject the baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire? Because they've seen it abused. You know what that's like saying? Imagine if I said to you, you know what, I ate food one time and I got food poisoning, so I'm not eating food anymore. How many of you know eventually I would die? That's the same way it is with a lot of injuries in the body of Christ. I say it all the time, that people are not rejecting truth. They're rejecting abuses to the truths that they have seen. If you see Jesus in the Word as He truly is, He is irresistible.
Amen?
Amen? He's irresistible. But let me show you this. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel, my messenger, to testify unto you these things in the churches. So where's the messengers to testify? In the church. In the church. In the church. Now, I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and morning star. Next verse, and then I'm going to go over to Romans 5. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. Do you know the Holy Spirit is still telling people to come? But when we catch this message, this testimony, this prophecy of Jesus, when we get a hold of that in the church, we're going to go out and tell people to come. The Spirit and the bride and the body and the church, we're going to be saying the same thing. We're going to be in unison. We're going to be telling people to come. And let him that is athirst come. What did Jesus say? If you drink of this water, you'll never thirst again. That's what he's talking about. The revelation of Jesus Christ. The reason people thirst for the things of the world is they don't know Jesus. I didn't say they wasn't born again. I said they don't know him. They don't know the intensity of his love for them. You know what blesses me? Is God doesn't reject me even when I'm rejecting me. That's amazing to me. I still get blown away by his love. And the church teaches you, be good, and God won't reject you. God won't reject you when you're not good. Now, should we not be good? No, because there can be bad things happen to that, but God is not a rejecter. And he's always saying, come. Come. Now, we'll come right back here and jump over to Hebrews 3:12, and I'll come right back here. Hebrews 3:12. because this goes right in line with what I want to say. Take heed, brethren. Whose brethren? You and I. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. I thought this was backsliding and rejecting and renouncing your faith. I'm not saying it can't lead to that, but that's not what this is saying. You know, our hearts can depart from God if we think He rejects us based on our performance. Did you know that? That's what God calls an evil heart of unbelief. Unbelief in what? The existence of God or in the work of Christ? Not the existence of God, the work of Christ. Amen. Oh, that's powerful. Next verse, look at this. Then what are we supposed to do? Here it is. It goes right in line with Revelation 22. But exhort one another. You know the word exhort? Parakaleo. It means call near, invite, summon. Summon. How often? Exhort one another. Every day. Why? This is why we confess our faults one to another. Not so we can gossip, but so we can remind each other. God's not rejecting you, and that's not who you are. Confess, look at this, to exhort, call near one another daily. Lest, while it is called today, don't wait on this. Don't wait on this. Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. You know why we don't pray? Let me say something before I get back into this. You know why we don't pray for people a lot of times? Don't command God's power? Sin consciousness. That's what it is. We're looking at ourselves and thinking, well, I know Matt Brown, he can do that because, you know, he's a fanatic and he's really into it and all that kind of stuff. But me? I mean, come on. I'm not as intense as him or this person or that person. No, that's not true. See, that's a sin consciousness. You're looking at you and not at him. See, that's why it says, exhort, call one another near on a daily basis while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness. This isn't talking about stubbing your toe and cussing. This is hardened through the deceitfulness of the definite article, sin, singular noun. It's the sin of not trusting in Him. That produces all sins. But it's that one sin. That's why He says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief that departs or pulls away from God because of sin consciousness. But exhort one another. Call them near. Summon them. Tell them God's not mad at them. Call on a daily basis while it is called today, lest any of them be hardened through the deceitfulness of the sin, singular sin, of not trusting in Jesus. Now back to Revelation 22:17. Watch this. This is good news. The gospel is still good news even after you're born again. Amen. Amen? And if we get a hold of this, we keep preaching it, we keep coming at it from every different angle, because this is what will change your life. If you receive the lie of condemnation, I guarantee you that's the spirit of Antichrist in the church, and it will eventually cause you to pull away from God. You'll depart from the living God. That's why we exhort you daily. So many times I want to preach on other things, and God says, take it back here. They don't get it. They don't get it. God is in love with you. And you can't change that. You can reject it, but you can't change it. Isn't that good news? I'm exhorting you daily. I only have many of you once a week, some of you once every whatever. You need it more than that. I'm here to tell you, you can't just get a little dabble, do you, once in a while. You got to hear it constantly. You need to be called near daily. God is saying, come near. Come near, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of that one sin of not trusting in Jesus. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that is here says, come. This is all about the restored hand, guys. When the heart is restored in a correct understanding of what Jesus Christ has done, our activities will be restored. It won't be a dead work. It'll be a work of faith. Amen. And the Spirit and the bride say, come, and let him that is the thirst come, and whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Next verse. For I testify unto anybody that teaches, that hears the words of these prophecies, and if he adds to it, God will add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And the next verse says, if any man takes away from it, God will take away his part out of the book of life. It had to be in the book of life for God to take it out. That's right. Amen. How many of you know the book of Revelation is for you and I today?
Amen.
Amen. Rich was asking me earlier today, we were talking about it. I said, oh, believe me, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, and it's for us. Amen. All right, go jump back to one more. I'm going to show you one more. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Romans 5, 8, and then we'll go back to Mark 3. Romans 5 and verse 8. Okay. But God commendeth his love toward us, or demonstrates his love towards us. God demonstrates his love toward us. Watch this. How did he do it? In that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Think about that. While we were, many God haters, Jesus still died for you. Isn't that amazing? He demonstrated it. Next verse. I love this. Much more than, are you born again? Much more than, being justified or declared righteous by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath or judgment from God through him. You know, the church doesn't get the much more part.
That's right.
It's usually much less because you should know better now. Right? It's how many know it's much more? How many know it's much more? Stay here. I'm going to come right back. We're going to come right back to Romans 5, 9. Jump over to Hebrews 6. I'm going to show you this. Verse 1. I want to show you this. Watch this. This is amazing. Therefore, leaving the principles or going on or building on the basic elementary principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto or upon the perfection. That's what the Greek says. Not laying again. I'm going to talk about the two things. Not laying again the foundation. Everybody say the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward, or the Greek says, faith upon God. You know, if you don't repent of trying to be right in your own strength, you can't effectively have your faith in God.
Amen.
See, and what this will do is it'll produce a withered hand in the church. A church that doesn't function the way God desires it to function. You know, many people, legalistic churches can get people to work. Do you know that? You know, I can get you going. I could get up here, not you guys, because you already know, but I could condemn you and I could say, how many of you aren't praying enough? Heads would go down. You're more concerned about your air condition than prayer condition. You know, I've heard all those cutesy things. You know, it's, but you know, we get, and people, they, you know why? Because they're identifying with their works instead of his work. And see, that won't produce condemnation or arrogance and self-righteousness, one or the other. One or the other. Because you'll deceive yourself. I can look down on people because, after all, I've got it going on. You know, if I fear a sin in my life, it's the sin of self-righteousness. And I do. I that's what concerns me. We talk to our kids. Listen, you don't be like that because that kid on the bus. You don't know what that kid's going through. You don't know what his home life is like. You don't know what's going on there. He needs you to love him right where he's at. Not condone wrong behavior. And that's not what we're talking about. Wrong is still wrong. Amen? So that's not... See, even the very fact that people hear that. Therefore, leaving you, not laying again the foundation of repentance, not from sins, but from dead works. From trying to atone or trying to please God with my performance. And then this is what gets me, and a faith toward or faith upon God. You can't have your faith upon God if your faith is still in you and you haven't repented of dead works. You haven't got it settled in your heart that it's not about what I do, it's about what he did. You know, in many churches, I've heard this terminology used before. You come and they make worker bees out of you. And we're called to perform. But listen, you got to get it in your heart that you're not right because of what you do. And see, and that's hard for people. Well, then what will keep me motivated? How about the love of Christ will constrain you, 2 Corinthians 5:14. The love of Christ will compel you. That's where God wants us to be.
Amen.
That's the good works you've been ordained unto. See, but so many people do things out of guilt, not out of a leading from God. There's a difference, guys. See, I'm calling you near. I'm telling you, God loves you even if you haven't done very well this week. God's not rejecting you because of your performance. So all people know that. No, they don't. I'm telling you, they don't. You can't be sad if you knew that. I'm going to show you that. Romans 5. Back to verse, 9. Romans 5, because we're after something here. Watch this. And then we're going to get to Mark 3. I know you don't think we are, but we are. Much more than. If God demonstrated his love toward me, that while I was a sinner, Christ died for me. Much more than. Somebody say, much more than. You know what that means? A whole lot more. Right? Much more than being not now. Everybody say now. Now justified or declared righteous by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath or judgment through him. Next verse. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled. The word reconciled means restored to favor. Restored to favor. Amen? What favor? The same favor that Jesus has with the Father. That's what you've been restored to. Oh, wow. Much more than being reconciled or restored to favor by the death of his son. Watch this. Much more. There it is again. Everybody say much more. Being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Now it's interesting. The word save means to be delivered, to be healed, to be preserved from danger, to be safe. Are you hearing me? Look at that. We're restored to favor. We're preserved from danger. We're healed by his life. The Bible says in Romans 4:25, he was delivered for our offenses, but he was raised for our justification, our declaration that we are right with God. You know what it means to be righteous? The way it should be. Next verse. Here's what I'm after. Watch this. And not only so, but we also joy in God. We have joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. I do not like the King James translation here. It should be reconciliation. Here's what the Greek means. Are you ready? It means exchange. I like to say this. Jesus Christ did not come to change your life. He came to exchange your life. You say, is there a difference? Absolutely. Absolutely. You're not called to live for God. You're called to allow God to live through you. Are you hearing me? It's a big difference. He's all you're splitting hairs. No, I'm not. It's day and night. Oh, so exchange. We have now received the atonement. It means adjustment of a difference. It means reconciliation, or it means restoration to favor. Do you get that? You have the same favor with God the Father as Jesus the Son of God has. Yes. Now we can all say amen to that. But what's your heart saying? Yes. See, because your actions are a result of what your heart believes. Back to Mark 3:1. Watch this. That's why Jesus goes into the church and he finds many people with withered hands. Why? Because of hearts that don't believe correctly about the redemptive work of Christ. We're coming back here. Jump over to Proverbs 17:20. Watch this. Proverbs 17:20. Look at this. He that hath a froward heart, leave that up there, a froward heart, or a perverse heart, or a heart that's messed up, not talking about your physical blood pump, but talking about your inner understanding of the redemptive work of Christ, he that has a froward heart, he finds no good. He finds no good. And he that hath the perverse tongue falleth into mischief. Notice how your tongue is connected to your heart. Proverbs 14:30, since we're in Proverbs. Watch this one. This is a good one. Watch this one. A sound heart, a healed heart, a healed heart. You see that? Marpe in Hebrew is the life of the flesh. Are you seeing that? That's why you need to be called near on a daily basis. There's many in the church, in the religious system, they've got withered hands because their heart's messed up in their understanding of what Jesus did. And man, if you're not focused on this 24/7, that stuff wants to creep back in all the time. I fight with it. It's called the good fight of faith. That's why it's a good fight, because Jesus already won, but it's nonetheless a fight. And he gave us all the weapons. We got a newborn again spirit. We got the word of God, and we got the Holy Ghost. Pretty good. The deck is stacked in our favor, but you got to partake. It's called faith. See, what faith is believing in the goodness of God through His Son Jesus on your behalf. What unbelief is faith in you. Whether it's in you good or you bad, it's still unbelief. Are you seeing it? Unbelief isn't, I don't believe there's God. That's just stupidity. Okay? We're not talking about that. But unbelief for the Christian is not putting faith in what Jesus did. That's why there's so many withered hands in the synagogue, in the religious system, in the church system. I told the story a couple weeks ago about going out on the streets with a brother from another state, and he was talking. I could just hear the condemnation in his voice. He loves God. He can quote scripture. He's got all this, but he's always about what he's not. This ain't about what you're not in yourself. This is about who you are in Christ, in you, the hope of glory. That's why the Bible says by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are sanctified, Hebrews 10:14. Christianity is not about your sacrifice for God. It's about his sacrifice for you. You keep your faith in that and it'll change your life. Amen. Christians are constantly motivated out of guilt and out of doing something to be something they already are. And that's why you got to constantly, and hear me, everybody say constantly. The Bible says daily. Exhort one another. You got to hear this all the time or it will slip. Guaranteed. I'm getting ready to do a post, I think, on the proverbial frog in the kettle. Because people say, I got that grace message, I'm good. And then they pull away from it. But like the frog in the kettle, the legalistic temperature's turned up 1 degree at a time. Yes. Yes. You can't really notice it. Oh, that's not bad, I got it. Oh, I'm good. Or it's like two people walking in a straight line, and the straight line represents truth. And God's on that straight line, and you're hooked with Him. If you unhook, well, you're still right there. You can still touch each other. But you let that go out for some time, and you'll be way over here. And the truth will be right here. Amen? A sound heart is the life of the flesh, but envy the rottenness of the bones. So a healed heart. Now back to Mark chapter 3, verse 1. Jesus entered the synagogue and he found a man with a withered hand. Withered hand speaks of an impaired ability to function in the works that God has ordained you unto. Ephesians 2:10. Amen? Now go to the next verse. We're just about done. You know what? Before we do that, thank you, Jesus. I didn't get to the next verse. Back to Romans. Let's finish Romans and we'll come back here because I want you to see Romans 5:8. 5:10, and then we'll go right into 8. Because this is all part of the heart and the withered hand. Okay? Verse 10. We were enemies. We were reconciled to God or restored to favor to God by the death of His Son. Much more, being now justified, we shall be saved by His life. Next verse. Here's why we joy in God. We have joy in God through Jesus Christ. One more. 1 Peter 1:21. I love this verse. I've used it many times. In fact, I'm thinking about getting a tattoo and using this verse on my tattoo. Not really. But if I did, it would be this verse. Who by Him or through Him do believe in God. How do we believe in God? Through Jesus or through just believing God, the existence of God? The Bible says in James 2:19, the devils believe in God and tremble. How many know the devils aren't born again? Amen. Amen? Okay. We can all agree on that, right? The devils aren't born again, but they believe in God and tremble. People a lot of times walk in what I call devil faith. They believe in God, but they have a trepidation. There's not a confidence. I'm not talking about the fear reverence of God. That's different. Okay? But who through Him we believe in God that raised Him up from the dead and gave Him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God. Your faith and hope cannot be in God if you're not believing in God through the redemptive work of Christ. It won't be in God. Your faith and hope won't be in God. Why? Because it's through yourself. You can't have confidence. Your faith and hope cannot rest securely in God if it's through you. Now back to Mark 3:1. Once again, a sound heart is the life of the flesh. Jesus went into the synagogue, found a man with a withered hand. Okay, Mark 3:1, that's good though. And verse 2, and they watched him whether he would heal on the Sabbath day that they might accuse him. Man, I could camp here. You know, a lot of people, I say this on Facebook a lot. A lot of people are not trying to catch what you say. They're trying to catch you in what you say. You know, they listened to Jesus trying to catch something out of his mouth so they could accuse him. You know, that's a work of the devil. That's the work of the devil. Rather than hearing what people are saying, I'm just waiting for them to say something wrong. I'll just get a little confession here. That's why some Christian shows I can't watch, because my heart's wrong. Because I'll just sit there to try to find out what they're saying wrong. Let it go, Chris. Amen? Let it go. So what? I let it go. Amen? Okay. I know that shocks people. But once again, growth is willing to be wrong. Willing to be corrected. Most people are not. I'm telling you, I watch it. I'll tell you, that's why religion is so dangerous. Jesus said, I believe it was in Matthew 23, he says, you'll compass land and sea to make one proselyte, one convert, and once he's converted, he's twofold more the child of hell than your son. You know what he's saying? He's saying, once you get him under religious doctrine, he ain't going to hear nothing because he already knows everything. It's like there's a fog over people. They can't hear because they already know. It's hard to learn if you already know. And they watched him whether he would heal on the Sabbath day that they might accuse him. And that's, of course, that's exactly what religion does. Man's religion, I wrote this down, will watch what you do with a motive to accuse, trying to catch you in what you say. And you can reference that in Luke 11, 53 and 54. Next verse. I like this. Jesus said something, and he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, stand forth. You know what God says to you and I? Stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Galatians 5:1. Stand fast. Ephesians chapter 6, he talks about stand, stand, stand. God's saying the same thing to you and I. This man has the withered hand, and God's saying, you stand. Next verse. Just about done. Only going to say. And he saith unto him, he saith unto them, the religious leaders. You know, religion doesn't make any sense. It just doesn't make any sense. And I've said this many times. I drive on these back roads and I see people that can't have electricity, but they can have tractors and loaders. I'm like going, I try to figure out who decides this. I mean, where's the hierarchy? It's ridiculous. It's religion. That's why I was talking about baptisms last night, and I was sharing how when I water baptize, I have to clarify that, people say, you baptize in the name of Jesus only, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. I do both. I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit in the authority of Jesus' name. So when they say, you baptize in the name of Jesus only, yep. You baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, yep. We cover it both. You know why? Because it's foolishness. All it is man being stupid. Was that too hard to understand? And he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days or to do evil? You know, he was the Sabbath. You know that? The Sabbath was a picture and a type of Christ. The word Sabbath means to rest or cessation. Jesus is our Sabbath. How many of you know that? You know, I've talked about this before. That's why that little baby boy in the Old Testament was circumcised on the eighth day. Why the eighth day? And why just the boys? What about the girls? The eighth day guaranteed that that baby boy would go completely through a Sabbath. Right? Because the Sabbath was the seventh day. You got to go completely through the Sabbath, Jesus. You know, even Christians, we got to go completely through the Sabbath. We got to go through Jesus for anything. We believe in God through Jesus. I just read it, Mark, in 1 Peter, right? But why the boys? What about the girls? Because once again, it's a type and a shadow. The life-generating principle flows from the man. In the new covenant, it's circumcision of heart. Male and female. That's in Christ, there's neither male nor female. But in the world, there is, Supreme Court.
Amen.
See, people take... I'm telling you guys, if you don't understand the word, you are a sitting duck for Satan's bullets of deception. Amen. And he wants to stop... He wants to confuse the body of Christ. He wants... Okay, you're in the synagogue, you're in the religious system, but just stay there with your withered hand and don't stand like God's calling you to stand. That's what the enemy wants. He cannot keep you from getting born again. You're already born again. But his next goal is if you can get under some kind of goofball doctrine that keeps you from the fullness of Christ. And he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they held their peace. I looked up the word save once again, keep safe, sound, to rescue from Make well, to rescue from, what is that? I can't even read my own writing. I write in tongues. In other words, it means to heal. It's sozo is the Greek word. Once again, people ask you how you're doing, just say sozo. But here's what I'm after. The word kill, it means to destroy or to allow to perish. That's what got me, to allow to perish. He saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days or to do evil, to save life or to allow to perish? Isn't that interesting? I'm just letting that hang for a little bit. You know, when we don't present truth, we're allowing things. Yeah. Do you know if I don't ever say anything about the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire, I'm basically saying something. What did Bonhoeffer say? To not say anything is to say something. To not do anything is to do something. And he was killed by the Nazis, by the way. Dietrich Bonhoeffer. But see, when you don't say something, you are saying something. Amen? You know, I'm going to ask a pastor in this area, and we're going to have a conversation. I'm not telling you who it is, but I'm just going to tell you what I'm going to ask. I'm going to say, is it wrong, in your opinion, I want this guy's opinion, is it wrong for me to be concerned about churches that are condoning abortion, that are condoning gay marriage? I mean, I can tell you right now, there's a big popular church, not in Greenville, so give it up. And the preacher of that church basically said, hey, told this other minister in that same denomination, well, you marry people that are living together, so what's the difference in marrying people that are gay? And the guy said, it's a big difference. But I'm saying, is it wrong for me? Is there right and wrong anymore? Or do we just get people to say a prayer? I'm not talking about not loving people or not being legalistic. I tell people, we love gay people. We want them to come, but we're not going to condone that lifestyle. Amen. We love gossips, but we're not condoning gossiping. See, there's a difference. Is there right and wrong anymore? See, this is what the enemy's plan is in the church. Is to get it so watered down. I mean, I've said this before. I see where people say, well, don't get hung up on voting. It's not that big a deal. That's the world stuff. We got stuff in the church, but yet we talk about reaching the world. Listen to me. It is the church's stuff. We need to be involved. We need to pray. We need to vote and we need to pray. You know, if we get meatheads in there, you know, a small minority is dictating this whole system, and it's wrong. And if the 25 million Christians that did not vote in the last presidential election would vote and vote pro-life, pro-family, pro-God, guess what? They'd be asking us, what do y'all want? They would be. I talked to a kid just this week. My wife and I talked to him. 29 years old. He's not a kid. Young man, 29 years old. And I was talking to him about voting. He said, no, I don't vote. I wanted to slap him. Smart mouth kid. I did. I wanted to just listen. And he was like, he had like a smirk on his face. I'm thinking, you don't want to learn, do you? You just want to sit here and let somebody tell you something and think it's God? It's not God. The wicked walk on every side when the vilest men are exalted. That's how it is. Yeah. And if we don't vote, it's our fault. Come on. It's our fault. And we need to. You say, oh, you're getting political. Absolutely. The church needs to be political. I am thrilled that at Karis Bible College, in their third year, they are starting a third year elective on getting into government and politics. It's about time. Amen. It's about time. And you know what? We can elect godly officials. And I've heard Christians say, well, it's just going to get worse anyhow. Just let it get. Listen, whatever that means, we delay it as long as we can. So it's not God's will that any perish, but all should come to repentance. If we pray for those that are in authority, as long as we can delay this, the more people that can get born again, that is awesome. Amen. Amen. Pray, vote, pray. There you go. Back to Mark 6. I'm gonna finish this quick. I really am. I know you think I'm lying, but I really am. I'm not lying. Look at this. Next verse. And he saith unto them, but they held their peace. And when he looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts. Now these were people in the religious system. Right. And he looked round about upon them with anger. Guys, there is a righteous, holy anger. Do you know you're called to be angry? A lot of people don't know that. Ephesians 4, 26, watch this, and 27, watch. I'm going to show you this. Ephesians 4, 26 and 27. And we'll come right back to Mark 3, 5. Just about done. Be ye angry and sin not. Be angry and don't sin. You're commanded to be angry. But how can you be angry and not sin? Because you're not directing this at people. Okay? You're directing at what's behind people many times. But see, the Bible says, you that love the Lord, hate sin. Psalm 97:10. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride, arrogance, the evil way, and the perverse mouth I hate. Proverbs 8:13. So we're commanded to do these. A lot of people don't know this. Oh, love. And see, a lot of Christians don't even know the difference between love and tolerance. There's a difference, guys. I watch this. Be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. This is not talking about in marriage. This is not talking about God approving of sin during daylight hours, but as long as you get it confessed before you go to bed. That's not what this is talking about. Look at the next verse. Let not the sun go down on your wrath, neither give place to the devil. If you stop being angry at what's hurting people, you're giving place to the devil. You know, this year's political election, at a lot of levels, you know, there's an anger involved. And you know, good. Now, the Bible says in James 1, the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. And there is a difference, okay? Don't have time to go on. But there's also a righteous, holy anger. I am angry at the lies that have been perpetrated on the American people. I am angry. And it's a righteous anger. I don't hate anybody. I don't. I really don't. I pray for their salvation. I do. God is my witness. But I hate what they stand for because they're pawns in the hand of Satan. Yes. And I don't know who is and who is, but I know this. This country belongs to Jesus. Amen. And so we give place to the devil when we stop being angry at evil. Jesus got angry. How many of you know when he overturned the money changer's table in the temple, he wasn't saying, hey, how's it going? Give me five. He was upset. Mark chapter 3, verse 5. We're just about done. Mark 3, 5. And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts. You know what's amazing? This man had a withered hand and they didn't care. Yeah. Isn't that amazing? I read some of these things in the Gospels and I think, does anybody care about the guy? And just a thought. Does anybody have any concern for the individual? So he was grieved, and I like what he says. For the hardness of their heart, he saith unto the man, stretch forth thy hand. I believe God's saying that to you and I. Stretch yourself. Can I tell you something that this 3-week revival did to me? It stretched me in a good way. I saw healing take place in my heart. I saw a desire to be involved with other pastors. There's a thought. You just see. Guys, can I tell you something? I've studied cults. And you know, there's a difference when they call you a cult for believing in healing. That's fine. I take that as a compliment. Okay? But when they call you a cult because you're elite and you think you're the only one and you got a corner on God, that's a cultic tendency, guys. We're not the only one. God's wanting the body of Christ to shake the world. That's what he wants. That's what he desires. Amen? And I'm not going to let the fact that somebody may not believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I'm not going to let that stop me from locking arms with them and standing up for the gospel. I believe it's important. I'll talk about it. I'll do all those things. But I don't want to let it be divisive. We need to shake the world. Guys, we've got a short time on this planet. Amen. All right. So he said, stretch forth your hand, and he stretched it out. And notice when you stretch out your hand, it's restored. When you get out of your comfort zone, when you get out of your four walls, when you get out of this and you start locking arms and getting rubbed the wrong way, guess what? Your hand's restored. You can begin to function the way God wants you to function. Amen? I love the freedom. I'm so excited about seeing people get saved. I'm so excited about discipleship. I'm so excited. Listen, can I tell you something? They have a discipleship book. You go through it. It starts with creation. It goes through Jonah, all these different books. When I get to the book of Job, I'll fix it. Don't worry about that. We'll teach it the right way.
You think you know everything about Job? No, I don't think I know everything about Job, but I do know a little bit about Job, and I know God didn't do that to Job.
Amen. That's right.
But it isn't going to happen if I stay and I don't interact. God's going to stretch me. He's going to say, stand forth, stretch forth your hand, and when you stretch it forth, it's restored, you're healed. That's why forgiveness is so powerful, guys. You know, forgiveness will heal you. Do you know that? It'll heal you. Like for years, I've been offended at my brother, Scott, because he says he beat me in 4 miles, and he didn't beat me. We were jogging together one time. Like, I think 4 miles, and then I didn't even think nothing of it. And then he got back, and then he made sure he was a step or two ahead at the end. Forgot about it. So all those years, he's been going around telling people he beat me. I never even knew he was doing that. Well, I found out about it. And so I've had to forgive him. Moving right along. That's a true story. He did do that. And he was telling people that he beat me, and we were just, I didn't even think nothing of it, so he just made sure he was like a step ahead of me when we were done, and he calls that a victory. That's what happens when you're what I call athletically insecure. Next verse. One more. And the Pharisees went forth. Now, you talk about a hardness of heart here. Watch this. And the Pharisees went forth, the religious folks, and immediately took counsel with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. Isn't that amazing? A guy gets healed, and they get together and say, how can we destroy this guy? That's a hard heart. That's a hard heart. Amen? So, anyhow, God wants to heal us. And it comes by understanding that, number one, he's not mad at us. But if we realize that God, watch this. If you understand that God's not upset and mad with you, watch this. He's also not upset and mad at your brethren, even those that may not go to your church. If they don't know that, that's a whole nother deal. Maybe you can lovingly share that with them. Amen? God wants to restore the withered hand so we can function the way he's called us to function. Amen. You're blessed.